Aloha, everybody. It is me, Jeremy Vaeni, and I am back with yet another episode. This one featuring Crystal, if you recall her, having an out-of-body experience on a massage table that led to a whole bunch of sort of interdimensional wackiness. Her brother, Robert, who had his own UFO sighting, and he was on to talk about that. And a third sibling will also make an appearance in what is kind of synchronous. She will remain anonymous. But I tell a story during this episode that relates to their story of a radio mysteriously going on. And so in my story, I talk about that and a candle holder breaking in half on its own during a Ouija board session. I'm sure I've told this on the show before, but I tell it again. And unbeknownst to me, in the audio that Robert sent me of him and his sister talking about some of her experiences, the anonymous sister, she too didn't just have the radio go on. She also had an experience of a candle being thrown across the room. So this thing of radios and candles is synchronous. At least that's what I'm saying. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Anyway, the three of them will be on in what I hope is an artfully pasted together episode, weaving in and out of his conversation with the anonymous sister. You'll see what I mean, at least if you're a subscriber. If you're a non-subscriber, you might not even make it that far before the episode ends for you. So please consider plunking down your hard-earned cash and subscribing when the subscription is available. I don't know that it is, because I know Whitley has had problems with the website, which have led to subscribers, well, which has led to him not being able to take new subscribers. So I don't know if that's gotten worked out or not. I suspect not. So this might be a moot point. But imagine once he gets that fixed, how many episodes of Dreamland in the Experience you're going to be able to hear in their entirety that you've missed for the better part of like a year, right? At least. Commercial free. And all of the other stuff that he's got on tap. So that should be exciting for any non-subscriber who's like been chomping at the bit to subscribe and just simply hasn't been able to. Or he's fixed it and I don't know it, and so he's losing money because I'm telling people not to subscribe, indirectly telling them that, that they can't. One way or another, I know Whitley's losing money. So sorry, Whitley. In any event, so after this episode, I realized I haven't really said much while I've switched to this new format. So I'm going to have a long, rambly chat after the interview. Well, not chat, but monologue. I guess I'm going to monologue at you, riffing off of my feelings about this episode, some sort of insights I've had, leading into some articles and other news that I've read or heard in the last few weeks, and sort of tie it all together, sort of, kind of, in a rambly, incoherent way, you know, how I do. That's worth the price of admission right there if you're not a subscriber. Oh, I'm really selling it, aren't I? What else do I want to tell you? Oh, I know. So Crystal would like to do a roundtable chat with female experiencers, an exclusively female roundtable chat, which I think is a great idea. And I offered her to actually host it if she would like, and I will just do the recording. So she's game. Are you game? Any female listeners out there who would like to take part in a roundtable chat hosted by Crystal? Write to me, jeremy@unknowncountry.com, and I will coordinate the effort on Crystal's behalf. And if any of you out there in listener land would like to host this show, doesn't have to be the full 2 hours, but it can be up to 2 hours. If you've got an idea for a show that you don't want to be a guest on, but you would like to host, again, shoot me an email, jeremy@unknowncountry.com, because this is something that I've enjoyed doing since me old Paratopia days with Jeff Ritzman, where we had listeners host their own shows. I can be involved as much or as little as you want me to be. I can record everything and sit back and just be on mute, and then edit it, of course, and put it online. Or I can be on your panel. I can be a guest. I can be a co-host, whatever you need. If that appeals to you, let's get to it. Let's do it. Come on. Time's a-wasting. Let's have that Dr. Phil intervention with your family. Whatever it is. Mom, Dad, I think you've been abducted by aliens, by aliens, by aliens. Yeah, let's do it. All right. For now, I thank you again for tuning in, and now let's get into it. This is a multi-layered show, in a sense, that Robert and Crystal thought something paranormal might be happening to them, and it turned out to have a mundane origin, but then the paranormal seemed to use it in some way, very trickster-like, in my opinion. And this leads into an interaction with the third sibling. So I'll leave it at that. This is just what happens, folks, when you live a paranormal life in a paranormally prone family, I guess. And I wonder how much more of this stuff would be going on if the family members were as into figuring this stuff out as Robert and Crystal are. I don't know whether they are or aren't. I suspect, though, that they aren't. They definitely say that one family member is skeptical, even though he's had some experiences. So wouldn't it be interesting if, like, there was a whole family of people who were just as in-depth interested in figuring this stuff out? Would their lives be just become a complete circus? I wonder. Well, here's the paranormal trying to make a circus of their lives either way. If you're a non-subscriber, we're going to begin after these commercials. For subscribers, let's begin right now. Aloha, Jeremy Vaeni here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge. If we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, oh, what a pleasure to finally have them both at the same time. Please welcome the brother and sister act. Well, they're not really acting, but of Crystal. Well, she's the sister. So let's try that again. I'm good at this podcasting thing. The brother and sister act of Robert and Crystal.
Hi.
Hello.
We have done acts before together, so it's fun.
Have you, like, talent shows and things? So what brings us together this time is something sort of twisty and turny in a way. And I guess we'll get into that. But first, I know that Robert, you actually wrote to me that there's something that you wish you had said during the solo episode we did together. And I thought maybe we could talk about that a little bit. you'd actually asked if I would add it into the episode, and I'm a bit of a tyrant, so I said no. So here we are. What is it that you wanted to talk about that we didn't get to?
Oh, sure, yeah. And anyone else chime in, because this is definitely a group process. And to your listeners, I want to say that, you know, I'm no expert. I haven't studied this. I haven't written books on this. But Jeremy has mentioned on the experience that he's open to interviewing the listeners, and I'm certain that the listeners out there have stories and just ideas to share. So please, I'm about to share an idea that's based on other people's stories and some speculation. So bear with me on that. But also, please do the same. Please bring your ideas to the show. This what I want to talk about is very similar to the sensing exercise that Whitley Strieber has talked about, and that Crystal has participated or experimented with as well. A friend of mine, when I was living in Belize, was having experiences with shadow people. He was having hauntings in so many different apartments that he lived in with other housemates, and also when he was living with his mom. He had a lot of paranormal experiences besides shadow people. His mom came into his bedroom at night, heard someone talking another language, and saw that he was sleeping. And the same thing happened with singing. She would hear singing in his room, but it wasn't him. It was another voice. And so as an adult, he was seeing shadow people. They would follow him around. He is an archaeologist that works on Maya ruins, does excavations. And he felt that the shadow people thing started after he was doing excavations. He suspected it might have followed him home. And he did a lot of – he didn't like it. He dates men. He had a boyfriend that was, he believes, attacked in his bed while sleeping and had a scratch on his face. He claims that this happened because of the attacker being something that wasn't in the room. He jumped on his boyfriend to cover him with his body and just tried to embrace him and stop it. And it did stop the attack. But he was seeking help from exorcisms from many different religions, even a Mormon priest, other priests that tried to expel this. He tried staging. None of these things were working. He wanted it all to stop. He was not a fan of it. It was scary to him, and I think it was preying on some negativity that he was experiencing in his life. That's wild speculation again. But he did an exercise, an imagination exercise. It wasn't on purpose. It actually happened on accident. He was noticing, I'll just add another detail that he shared with me that I thought was interesting, that sometimes at the same time as the shadow people, when you would witness shadow people, there was sometimes also a white mist that would come out of nowhere and float through. And he felt a benevolence from the white mist. He doesn't know why it would sometimes be in conjunction with the shadow people. But he had an imagining one time that put an end to this up until when I last was speaking to him. So we're talking about a matter of a year or so without hauntings or visits. He was imagining stars in the sky that began swirling above him. And the light of the star swirled into one spiral and then into one beam of light in the center that came down into his crown, through his head, into his body. And that light shone bright and expelled whatever negative energies he was feeling, whatever negative energies were in his presence, and he did not have any more of these visits. But he associated it with the white mist in some way, this benevolent white mist, and I don't know the connection there. Maybe that's what he was seeing before he did this exercise, but he feels like he used this sort of imagining of light as a defense or to get a good riddance of these presences that were not welcome. And I wanted to share that exercise because I've done a similar one myself where I felt someone was an energy was approaching my space, entering my space, and I did an imagination exercise similar to Whitley Strieber's, where he would meditate on exciting all of the electrons in his body, you know, just one limb at a time, And until his whole body was like the energy of his, of all the electrons in his whole body were all vibrating with light. And then he, I would see my form, the form of my body, whatever position I'm laying in, like floating in space as a silhouette of just light, of just white light. And then, push that energy out in an orb away from my body and to, and out into the room and in, and around the house and to protect the house. And I felt like I had reclaimed my space in some way, the kind of thing you want to do when you sage a house. And it was all an imagination exercise. So that's, I want to talk about this a little more, but our imagination is kind of all we have when it comes to the paranormal. Science is not going to help us. We don't have repeatable results that are required of in the scientific method to, for science to help us through this kind of thing. And the results seem to change even when you try to, what two people's perspectives are different when they're looking at the same paranormal experience, as I'll get to later. But that was the thing that I wanted to liken to what Whitley does. He is being required to wake up at 3 a.m., I believe, and do a meditation. That's the sensing exercise, he calls it. And Crystal, you, do you mind sharing your experiences with the sensing exercise?
Well, mostly I had just been doing the sensing exercise to, because after I heard Whitley say that and before you had said, he'd been talking about it, and just as I was learning about more meditation and doing meditation, the sensing exercise made it sense to me to feel that, like, coming alive of all the electrons and the energy that came from that, because I, that energy flowing and moving through is something that I was experiencing from when I had that shock that ran through my body. And so I was very interested in learning about that and energy and maybe, I don't know, just feeling it. So I was doing the sensing exercise and you mentioned this to me and then it made sense together. And so then I had an experience where it was more of a dream, though. I was dreaming that there was something, it was right before waking up around 3 or 4 a.m. That's when I do wake up and a lot of times. And I was dreaming that there was this, it was a very hostile person, like, or energy spirit in my dream, you know, coming at me. And I thought about that, the light, and would make them go away. And it did. So that's what that would be my experience with that.
I think
so. I like the idea of using it as a possible, you know, setting out what we talked about. Again, what you put out there is what you get. So if I'm sending out light, then I'm going to get light back. The, what did you guys call that?
The more you get.
No. We're
creating your own reality. Power of intention. No.
There was like a circuit, some sort of word that meant circuit.
Power of now.
No. You've got
feedback loop.
Feedback loop, I think, is what you're saying. Yes, that's what I was thinking about.
Yeah, I guess you could just throw a dart at the wall. Eventually, you'll hit one of our catchphrases, you know?
Yes, exactly. I'm like, which one was it? Try to catch it. That's the one.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. do. And the afterlife revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle, it's available in paperback, and there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something, you can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Ann Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to the Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com, that's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
Well, as you guys are talking, it reminds me of, I remember interviewing a woman who swore that the only way to get rid of evil alien contact is to pray to Jesus. And I think the repeatable thing, there are two repeatable things actually in all of this. One is that whatever it is that we are perceiving, a mist or a shadow being or an alien or a ghost or whatever, we seem to intuit a feeling about it. And if we intuit a negative feeling about it, if we put our faith or our intention, I don't know what the right word would be, but just if we put our, faith into X, it doesn't matter what X is, just our ability to get rid of that feeling or get rid of that entity, it seems to work. It seems to block it out. So it can be Jesus, it can be meditation, it can be sage. So the repeatable things are these two things. You know what I mean? Even though the actual physical objects or rituals or meditations or prayers may not be repeatable in the way that science would want them to be.
Right.
Yeah, there's something what's super powerful about that statement in my interpretation is that it says that we can use our imagination to affect change in this other reality. And so I'm just going to set the stage here. Let's just assume, all skepticism aside, let's just assume that all these stories that are coming back where people are having these, for a moment, well, let's entertain the belief that there is this other reality and that there are these other intelligent beings there and that they can come here and visit our reality in some way. It seems that though we cannot control them, we cannot affect them physically, we don't have any way to manipulate their world or visit their world, it does seem in some way that we might have more control or ability than we are aware of. We know that they, if we're imagining that all of this is real, then we can take some similarities in people's stories. One of the great similarities is that they speak with the experiencers psychically. They speak without moving their mouths. So many of us, I'm not an abductee, and I haven't met any of these visitors, but so many people say that they do this thing. So if they're speaking with us psychically, that means we can know one, that our minds are psychically receptive. Two, that the psychic signal is coherent, that their voice is what they hear, like clear words and sentences and statements. And so that capacity means, since we are capable of that, it means that potentially we can send that back and that we can use that to influence them psychically and perhaps even influence their world by having a method perhaps to protect ourselves, imagining some form of resistance, which could be light and or Jesus, as some people might choose to, or saging, like you said. I think that's a very powerful notion that has a lot of potential, and I don't know what that potential is, but it's something that, you know, it's good for us all to pay attention to.
Yeah, and well, I mean, even in Crystal's situation where she's going to a rest stop and sees a light, and the light, you know, potentially is a portal. It ends up being sort of a look into another world. I mean, all of that is happening because something is trying to communicate with her slash you, Crystal. Right? So there's even something that is, I guess, powerful and necessary that we haven't figured out in the fact that there is a communication going on at all. Otherwise, mm-hmm. why bother? And obviously, to my mind, it has nothing to do with technologically advanced beings per se, because that seems like, it seems like these sorts of in and out stunts, you know, flitting into existence and out of existence and all of that, just what, hoping that you look up at the right time and all that sort of stuff, seems like a waste of alien tax dollars to me. So, but what do I know? But anyway, so I just want to sort of press that point that there's something that seems, again, to be necessary about the act of communicating, but what is necessary about it isn't a literal sit-down chat, right? Or else that would be happening. So, but there is something necessary about it, and we play a powerful role in that, whether we understand it or not. The end.
Yeah, it seems...
that wasn't, you know, for... The only thing I think of is like Pinky and Godly. They were, you know, they were there, and I did feel like there was a communication. Well, except for Godly, I guess it would be more psychic, but with Pinky speaking to me physically, like there, and touching Godly, you know, those things. So that, I don't know.
But also the fact that it was one in a series, like something happens to you. X happens to you. It opens you up to this, and you happen to be the type of person who is receptive to being open to these things. It kind of excites you. It doesn't make you curl up into a ball and go, God, am I psychotic? So is there something about you that there's something on the other side of the veil that is desperate almost to want to speak with us, that they would latch onto you and just try to force this communication, this constant communication? And I don't mean force in a bad way. I just mean there's something about it that seems pertinent to them.
Right. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what.
Well, Crystal,
this idea of being open to this communication, I think also leads us into why we contacted you this time about these phone calls and the sound that we were hearing.
Thank you for segueing me. Someone's got to do the job of the host. You might as well be the guest. Yes. So there are these sounds that you were hearing through... What sort of a headset on your cell phone? Is that what it is?
It wasn't my headset. It was
right.
Robert's
headset. Yeah. So Robert got this headset. He heard these sounds. They sent them to me because they were odd sounds. Although they were familiar to me. Like, I had a crappy headset that came with my little crappy phone, and it created a loud sort of annoying feedback noise. Not exactly like that. But anyway... you sent that to me, and I was kind of excited about it. I was like, oh, what could this be? Maybe this really is something, because it is overbearing. It's not just like some background hiss or something. It's like this overbearing, now we can't hear the people talking anymore. We just hear this bunch of clicking sounds and stuff.
Hello?
Hello?
Hey, yeah, so it didn't work. All right, so this time, I'm not using the headphones talking to you, and I definitely don't hear the sound. But see, I use these headphones all the time, these earbuds, and I've used them with other people, talking to other people, and I only hear it when I'm using the headphones. Oh, wait, it's back. Now it's back, and I'm not using the headphones.
Wait, you don't hear it? Is it happening right now?
Yeah. it's happening.
And so I sent it to Whitley Strieber, and he was concerned about it at first, but then he had his sound guy analyze it, and it turns out that the sound is, is of a technological sort of mundane origin. It is a feedback noise of sorts. But that said, of course, we're dealing with experiencers, and so we're dealing with trickster phenomena. There's something about, trickster phenomena where it's like, yeah, of course it's a mundane source. But now I'm going to use that. use that for a paranormal, undeniable sort of synchronicity. And so I guess if you want to take it from there, Robert, what was that?
Okay. Yeah. So I was convinced that it was just faulty wiring in the earbuds. At first, Crystal was the first one to notice it, and it got really loud in a conversation with her, and I wasn't hearing it at all. On my end, it was kind of quiet, actually almost imperceivable, but it was really loud on her end, and it was really funny because at first we were like, Crystal was like, it sounds almost like a language, like some kind of insect language. And I was like, oh, okay, well, why don't I be quiet and you try to communicate with it? and so she did, and I was just laughing. We were having a good time with it. But
did anything happen that you thought was communication, Crystal?
Well, for me, it was like what I was hearing. Well, first of all, he really wasn't hearing it for a couple of times, and I didn't. And I would say it, and then I would kind of ignore it. But this day, I just couldn't ignore it anymore. And I kept trying to say, no, there's this sound and it's really loud. And so finally he was like, well, what are you hearing? You know? And so then he's like, okay, we'll try to imitate it. And then he was the one who said it sounded insect-like. But to me, it didn't sound like just normal static. It sounded like there was different rhythms and tones and, you know, ups and downs and like pauses. And then it would get really loud and then it would get really soft. And like there was almost an emotional feel to what I was hearing on this end. And so being open to this idea that there's this channel and then thinking I teach language and we've lived in many countries, you heard many languages. It just felt like a language that I didn't understand more than it did faulty headphone static. So that's where that was at the beginning.
Yeah. Yeah. So I was pretty convinced it was just the headphones. So I called one of our other sisters. Crystal and I have two other sisters. Crystal's the youngest of the sisters. I'm the youngest of the four siblings. So I called the middle of the sisters, and just to say hi. And I was using the same headphones. And at first, I was wanting to be apologetic. I was like, "Are you receiving any static on the headphones? Because that's been happening." And I can just take them out. And she's like, no, the static, well, I don't think I said that, but I was thinking. And she said, no, there's no static. Everything sounds fine. And I was like, great. So we just had a great conversation. And then in the middle of, toward the, about 20 minutes into the conversation, the radio in front of her turned on. And wind started blowing a curtain suddenly at the very same time as the radio turning on. And she told me, she was like, Robert, the radio just turned on. And so she goes and turns it off, which requires turning a dial down until past a click. And then the curtain stopped blowing just right at the same time. It was just so weird. And instantly the static showed up for 5 seconds. That same static appeared. And my sister was like, oh my gosh, now I hear the static. We're both like getting in this weirded out moment of like, what's going on? And then the static stopped and did not come back for maybe 5 more minutes. We had the phone call was about 25 minutes total. And the only 5 seconds when there was static was right after this bizarre radio turning itself on experience.
Thank you again, Robert and Crystal and their mystery sibling for doing this episode. Thank you all for listening, and talk to you in a month. Next episode. Maybe even in the round table if we can get it together in time. All right. Take care.